and suggesting more potentially habitable real estate within our solar system and out into the cosmos. So today, we know that there are more planets than stars in the Milky Way, and that's a fundamental change in our perspective. When I was a student, we knew of 9 planets and lost one, and didn't know whether planets would be plentiful around other stars. In fact, we were just coming out of a period where the most popular theory for how planets formed were that 2 stars passed close to one another and pulled material out in the equatorial plane that eventually coalesced into planets. If that, in fact, had remained the correct theory for planet formation, planets would indeed be very, very rare. Today, the theory tells us that when a giant molecular cloud, kind of thing I described a little while ago, when it collapses and spins up and a star forms in the middle, it forms with this beautiful planetary disk around it from which the planets condense. And that all stars will do this, and therefore planets are plentiful. And that turns out to be correct. So, indeed, there is more potentially habitable real estate out there than we ever imagined. Potentially habitable. We have no idea whether any of it is in fact inhabited, but that's what this century is going to tell us. And so today, we are thinking about missions that could perhaps find life beyond Earth by looking for biosignatures within the planets and the moons of our own solar system and in exoplanet atmospheres that are now, these missions are now on the drawing board. And the upcoming decadal review of astronomy and astrophysics will have a lot to say about which, if any, of these missions get funded and come. So our atmosphere, the Earth's atmosphere, is extraordinarily different from the atmospheres of all the other planets in our solar system. And if you take a spectra, you can see the chemical fingerprints of water and carbon dioxide and oxygen and methane in the atmosphere of the Earth. Looks very, very different than the other atmospheres around us. And that's because of biology on the surface of this planet. We have in our atmosphere coexisting oxygen and methane. Oxygen from photosynthesis and methane from the anagens and cow farm. Those two gases do not like to coexist. They come together and form an equilibrium product, which is water vapor and carbon dioxide. And that's happening all the time in our atmosphere. But biology is so prolific and abundant on the surface of our planet that it keeps replenishing these two very reactive gases. That's the kind of thing we would like to see in the atmosphere of a distant planet. And then with enough context, with enough information about the nature of the planet and its star and its history, we might be able to presume from these biosignatures that there was in fact life on the planet's surface. Now, in addition, we at the SETI Institute and in other places around the world would like to look for mathematicians as well as microbes. And therefore, we're interested in searching for technosignatures. Now, our technology is visible from a distance, and their technology might be as well, right? It could be some vast communications network or shield against incoming asteroids or even something entirely unforeseeable. But it might be detectable if we do a systematic search for through a wide range of wavelengths and discover something that we can't explain naturally. So the search started a little more than 50 years ago using radio telescopes, and the beginning of this century we started to use optical telescopes, and now we're pushing those searches down into the near infrared so that we have a greater reach through the interstellar medium with its dust. And what we're looking for is something that's engineered rather than astrophysical. So with all these telescopes, we're looking for signals that don't look like the signals that Mother Nature produces. So I'm going to show you a diagram here, and I'm not going to explain much about it. It's what we call a waterfall plot. And we've broken out frequency on the horizontal axis and time on the vertical axis. And each one of those little dots is a measurement of power at a particular frequency at a particular moment of time. And probably there are people as old as I am in the audience that remember old television sets with the snow, all of that noise, 10% of which is actually coming from the galaxy. But that snowy noise, that's what astrophysics looks like. But there are traces in there which are clearly not noise. These are the sorts of artifacts that we're interested in finding. In the radio, we look for frequency compression, for signals that show up at only a narrow range of frequencies. So this is the way Mars looks to our radio telescopes at times when the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter and the Mars Express are on our side of the planet and broadcasting back to the Deep Space Network. That's the kind of thing we're looking for, artifacts. And whether or not SETI succeeds with its optical, infrared, radio searches for signals is going to depend on the longevity of technologies. I'll run that one again, right? We'll start that up again. Because unless technologies, on average, last for a long time, there are never going to be two technologies close enough in space to detect one another and coeval in time, lined up at the same time in this 10 billion year history of the Milky Way galaxy. We have to be close in space and close in time, and if technologies are short-lived, it's never going to happen. It's why Phil Morrison, one of the very early pioneers of the SETI research, called SETI the archaeology of our future. Archaeology, because any signal we detect, if it has any information that we can understand, is going to be telling us about their past, because it took the signal a long time to get here. But the very detection of a signal tells us that we have a potential for a long future, because that detection was only possible because technological civilizations live for a long time. So somebody else made it through their technological adolescence. That's the phase we're in now. If they did, we can too. So SETI is the archaeology of our future. And we've been doing this for a little more than 50 years. And if you take the multidimensional search space where we might find signals, all the directions, all the frequencies, all the modulation types, polarization, the power. If you take that multidimensional space and say, let's set the volume of that space equal to the volume of the Earth's oceans, and you ask, how much of that have we searched? Turns out it's 1 12-ounce glass out of the Earth's oceans. We've been working hard, but we haven't been able to do a great deal yet, because our tools haven't been up to the task. And certainly, if your question was not are there any other technological civilizations out there, but are there any fish in the ocean, and you did the experiment of scooping one glass and looking for fish, I mean, that experiment could work. You could have caught a fish in that class, but if you look and there are no fish, I don't think you're going to decide that there are no fish in the ocean. The experiment is not yet significant. That's where we are today. But we, in fact, are beginning to build tools that are commensurate with the vast size of this search. And we understand that the ocean is vast, and we are still very, very motivated to go and find what might be out there. So I'm showing you pictures of the Allen Telescope Array in Northern California near Mount Lassen. It's a telescope that's built as a large number of small dishes. It is hooked together with an incredible amount of computing, so silicon is as important as aluminum and steel. And we use these telescopes every day to scan for evidence of somebody's radio signals. And this telescope can grow in the future by adding dishes or adding more compute power. And of course, that latter is growing exponentially. And that's why we're so excited about the possibilities for the future. We've been doing this for a while, starting in 2011 when the Kepler spacecraft released its first data set on exoplanets. We started to observe stars where we knew there were exoplanets. Right? So here's a two-dimensional map of the sky. It's right ascension and declination, good astronomy coordinates, but basically it's the sky that you can see from the northern hemisphere. And you can see there's a big concentration right there, the Kepler field. We looked at that a whole lot until Kepler told us, and the ground-based searches for exoplanets, the statistics told us that every star has one or more planets. And so now, in the past year, we switched our observing strategy to look at the 20,000 closest stars, almost all of which are small red dwarf stars. And so you can see, because of our previous concentration on Kepler, there's a declination strip that is under-observed at the moment. We're filling that in. And then there's